Good morning, boys and girls. It's Mrs. Jordan again. Hello, how have you been? I know I have not been online for over a month now, and I'm sorry about that. We've just had several things, a couple big meetings going on at church and things that I just ran out of time, okay? So hopefully we're back. We're still studying our books of the Bible, and we're going to bow our heads and have a word of prayer, and then we're going to keep going, and we're now in the book of Acts, in the New Testament books, okay? All right, so let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Dear Lord, thank you for this morning. Thank you for your love for us. We thank you for your word and the privilege that we have to study it and to hide it in our hearts and to get it out to others. And Lord, I just pray that the one thing that we never forget is to get out there and to tell other people about your love for them, your dying on Calvary's cross to pay for their sins. Lord, may we never lose sight of what's the most important issue for the people out there in the world today. We just thank you for the children listening and the moms and dads who are listening. And we pray that your word would just mean so much to them and would guide and direct their lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, so boys and girls, we are still in the books of the Bible. We are in the New Testament books, which is the division now that man put in the Bible, okay? So the Old Testament books we've been through from Malachi to, and I'm going to hold up our little chart here. So we've been from Genesis to Malachi here. That's all about Israel's history, their prophets, their priests, their kings, and how they lived. All the history of Israel and how God dealt with them in the Old Testament books. Then, of course, we come to the 400 years of silence that we did not hear from God at all. Their religion was still there, but God did not speak from the heavens for 400 years. Then we come to what is in your Bible divided into New Testament books. But if you see, boys and girls, they're still all under the time past. They're all together here. So remember Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Matthew presents Jesus as a king. Mark presents Jesus as a servant. Luke presents Jesus as a man. And John presents Jesus as God. So that's what Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John did for you. It gave you each person's perspective on who Jesus was. Matthew was an apostle. John was an apostle. Luke and Mark were not. Mark was just a servant who served with Peter and Paul. Luke was a doctor, okay? And Luke was even with Paul. And Luke is important today, boys and girls, because now we're in the book of Acts. And Luke wrote the book of Acts, okay? So the first part of the book of Acts now today is still in the time past. All right, so we're going to talk a little bit about the book of Acts. The book of Acts is a transition period. It's a transition book. It's a changeover from one program coming into the new program. Now, we're still in Acts chapters 1 to 8. We're still in this time past, okay? So I'm going to give you an illustration of what I'm talking about. Now, if when you get older and get more into the scriptures, you're going to be studying that Israel's timeline history is in a time of 7 weeks. Okay, so kind of put that in the back of your mind. So this is, let me give you this illustration, and I got this from Mrs. Verstegen's book, the Book of Books. Now, Mrs. Verstegen tells a story that she's a tutor, and it's summertime, and for 7 weeks, remember the seven now, she is going to tutor a whole group of boys. So they go for 6 weeks, and at the end of the 6 weeks, a bunch of the boys are going to be off on vacation. Some of them I have the company come. Some of them got sick, so they could not meet for a few weeks. Okay, so they had to put on hold at the end of 6 weeks their tutoring session with Mrs. Verstegen. Now, or with their, we'll just say with their tutor. Okay, so while everyone is, she's waiting for everybody to get back to finish that 7th week of tutoring, she decides to tutor a different group, a whole group of girls. So for a time period until her boys get back, she is tutoring the girls. So there's a change there. There's a transition there. She's tutored the boys for 6 weeks. Now there's a break in there. And now she's going to tutor the girls until the boys come back. That is how we transition from time past, boys and girls, to the but now. Okay, so we're going to go over this story again when we get to Acts chapter 9. So a transition is a change. Now, she's going to go back to the boys to get their 7th week. But right now, she's in that but now. So next week, we're going to talk a little more about this when we get to chapter 9 in the book of Acts. But I was trying to get, what is a transition? Do you remember growing up when you were little, you got your first bicycle? Now, when you got on that bicycle, you had to have the help of the training wheels. Now, you could just jump on that bicycle with the training wheels and just ride, ride, ride. You weren't going to fall, were you? All right, so now you're too big. You've outgrown that bicycle with the training wheels. It's time to learn to get on the bicycle without the training wheels. So you're going to make a transition. You're going to make a change into a new, well, I don't want to say a new era, but into a new position. So you've had your bike with your training wheels. I'm too big for this bike now, Mom. Let me ride without the training wheels. So Mom and Dad take off the training wheels. Well, you just hop right on that bike, and what happens? You fall over. You got to learn again to ride the bike without the training wheels. So you transition. You change from, here I am steady with my bike with the training wheels. Now I'm going to get on the bike without the training wheels. So you need a little help there, right? So in the transition, the change from your bike with the training wheels to the bike with no training wheels, Mom and Dad has to hold the bike until you get steady, right? Now you're steady, you're there, Mom and Dad is holding onto the seat, and you start pedaling and they let go. Well, you pedal a ways and you realize sometimes Mom and Dad are running along with you, and then all of a sudden they let go. And you see, oh, I'm scared, and you fall. But you drive it a little bit, you ride it just a little bit. Mom and Dad's running with you. They're not touching it. And then you realize they don't have you. You fall, okay? Well, that's a transition. Well, then you get back up. You get on your bike. Mom and Dad hold it. Don't run with me, Mom and Dad. Let me go on my own. So you take off your wobbly and you finally get it. You've transitioned, boys and girls, from the bicycle with the trike to the bicycle with, I mean, bicycle with the training wheels, the bicycle with no training wheels. You've made the change. But in between, boys and girls, you fall down and you get back up. You fall down and you get back up. Well, that's what the book of Acts is about. You start out with Peter, and Peter is the main focus in the book of Acts when you first start. It's Peter and the 12, Peter and the apostles. So you're making a change, boys and girls, from the ministry of Peter and the apostles into the ministry of the time past into the but now ministry of Paul, our apostle. Just like you changed on that bicycle, the book of Acts is a change. And in between, boys and girls, you fell down, you got back up, you fell down. But you know what? In the book of Acts, Israel falls. They fall down, and we're going to talk about that, and then they just keep falling. They don't get back up yet, okay? But somebody else does get up, all right? So the transition, what I just wanted you to know is when you transition, you're making a change. You transition from your bike with the training wheels to the bike with no training wheels to, you know, I've got this, I can do this. And you stay on that bike with no training wheels the rest of your life. You don't go back, okay? All right, so the book of Acts, that's what this is. It's a transition. And it's showing us, too, that there's a pause in what God's doing with Israel. Like in the story of the tutor, Mrs. Verstegen, 6 weeks with the boys, and then she stops. And in between, she does several weeks with the girls. Then she's going to go back, and the seventh week, finish their tutoring session. They paid for 7 weeks. They are owed one, okay? So they're out there waiting when they all get back together for that seventh week of tutoring. That's the way Israel is. They've done 6 weeks with the Lord and failed. So now he's got a pause going, a transition, a change. And then, but God's going to go back to Israel. All right, so let's look at the book of Acts. So if you have your Bibles, turn to Acts chapter 1, right? And in Acts chapter 1, let's see, verse 3 kind of tells us what the book of Acts is about. It's talking about Christ and the ministry of Christ here. So the book of Acts chapter 1, let's see, let's start with 1. The former treaties have I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and teach. So the book of Acts starts out talking about all that Jesus began to do and to teach. Okay. Verse 2, until the day in which he was taken up, after that he, through the Holy Ghost, had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen. So Jesus was on the earth now, okay? To whom also he showed himself alive. Now, boys and girls, Jesus showed himself alive. When he was on earth, after he rose from the grave, went to heaven, presented himself to the Lord, to God, he came back. And here this verse says, to whom he also showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs. Many proofs, boys and girls, that Jesus had risen from the dead. And Jesus walked, okay, listen, being seen of them 40 days and speaking of things pertaining to the kingdom of God. So now we're in the Acts chapter 1, those first part of the book of Acts. We're still in the time past. Here's Jesus. He's giving them one more chance to know who he is and what he came there to do was to be their Messiah. So Jesus speaks and talks. And boys and girls, he talks. He is proving himself. He has conversations with people. Do you remember Thomas doubted who he was until he saw the wounds in his hands and his feet? Jesus is proving to their infallible proofs. And it says in verse 4, and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith, ye have heard of me. So Jesus is telling, he's commanding the apostles. He's there with them. He's showing himself to people, to Mary, to Martha, all these people. He's alive. For 40 days, he's on the earth. But he commands the apostles, boys and girls, not to leave Jerusalem, to stay in Jerusalem and to preach to the lost sheep of the house, the children of Israel in Jerusalem. Okay? So that's what he is commanding them to do. All right. So in Acts, okay, now look at verse 6. The apostles asked Jesus a question. They are still looking for that kingdom, boys and girls, the kingdom of God. So for 40 days, he's there. And then in Acts chapter 1, verse 6, let's read the verse. When they therefore were come together with the Lord, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? Okay, boys and girls, they still are looking for the kingdom to Israel, the kingdom that they are going to have on the earth. This is still there in that time past. Okay? All right. So, now in Acts chapter 1, verse 11, let's read. On verse 7, he says, it is not for you to know the times of the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power. In other words, it's not for you to know the times and the seasons when things are going to happen, but it's going to happen. But ye shall receive the Holy Ghost. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria, and then the uttermost parts of the earth. Okay, so when he had spoken these things, here it is, boys and girls, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. Okay, so here is the passage where Jesus is taken up into heaven, and he goes to heaven to stay. He's not come back yet. We're still in time past. The 12 apostles are staring up, and they see Jesus taken up into heaven. Okay. Now, in verse 10, it says, and while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven. All right. Then it says the apostles returned to Jerusalem from the Mount of Olives, which is from Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey. They went back to Jerusalem where God, the Lord Jesus Christ, told them to go. Okay, so he's taken up into heaven. The two men in white arraignment tell him, why stand you up? He's going to come back. Okay, now, boys and girls, their message is not our message. He's going to come back, but for Israel, it's not going to be good. All right, so in Acts chapter 1, verse 10, 9, 10, 11, he's taken up into heaven. Now, look over in Acts chapter 2, okay? Acts chapter 2, and let's look at verse 1. And when the day of Pentecost, which is one of their Sabbaths that they worshipped on, okay, was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. So they were all with one accord. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, boys and girls. Okay. And it sat upon each of them. So in other words, back here in chapter 1, verse 8, Jesus tells them, but ye shall receive the power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. In chapter 2, verse 1 to 4, it's happening. It's being fulfilled what Jesus said would happen to them, okay? So the 12 are there. The Holy Spirit comes like cloven tongues of fire and sits on them. Let's see. And they began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Boys and girls, it wasn't gibberish. It was other languages, okay? And there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men, out of every nation under heaven. So at Jerusalem were Jews out of every nation under heaven. All right, now this is what happened. Now when this was noised abroad, the multitude came together and were confounded. In other words, they're like, what is going on here? Here are the 12 apostles, the Holy Ghost. Now, it says the Holy Ghost because this is talking about who the Holy Ghost is. When the scripture says the Holy Spirit, that's talking about the Holy Spirit's job. But this is talking about the person of the Holy Ghost comes on them. Okay, it says they were confused, they were confounded because every man heard of them speak in his own language. So the Jews from all the nations were there, were represented there that day in Jerusalem. And when they saw what happened to the 12 apostles, and they started speaking in other tongues, not confused gibberish tongues, boys and girls. These Jews that had come from all the nations, they were so whoa, what's going on here? Because they could hear in their own language what the apostles were saying. And they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, behold, are not all these which speak Galileans? Aren't these all from Galilee? How can we understand in our language what these Galileans are saying? They have their own language. But God had them to speak in other tongues. Okay. And how we hear every man in our own tongue wherein we were born. All right. So boys and girls, on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit comes on the 12 apostles and they start speaking in other tongues so that all the Jewish people from all the other nations could hear and understand what the apostles were preaching. That's the miracle of what tongues was for Israel. It was what we don't need to speak in tongues today. But Israel, that was a sign for those that believe, okay? So, now in Acts 2:38, I'm going to read that. This is what the Holy Spirit through Peter tells Israel what they have to do. So turn to verse 38 in Acts chapter 2. All right. Now, then Acts 2:38. Peter has preached here in the chapter two, the rest of chapter 2, to the men of Israel. Okay. Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Okay, so Peter is telling them, this is Peter's new message. It's not a new, repent and be baptized, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Ghost that we have gotten. Okay, so that's what Peter's message is. And he's to stay in Jerusalem with the other apostles and preach that message. Okay, so we've gone through now the first couple books, chapters of the book of Acts. We're going to skip over now to chapter 6. is where we're going to go to. But all along now, Peter is preaching. Peter is the main focus, the main person. In the first six chapters, actually the first eight chapters into chapter nine, Peter is the important person here. He's in Jerusalem, he's head of the apostles, and that's where the ministry is supposed to be. In Jerusalem, in Judea, and then in Samaria, then the uttermost parts of the earth. Jerusalem has to get saved first, okay? According to repent and be baptized for the remissions of sin. All right, so we're going to turn over now to chapter 6. So here's where our change starts coming, right? Now, in Acts chapter 6, we are going to look at, it's got a heading here called the first deacons, but Stephen is one of these deacons, okay? So we're going to look in verse 8. Now this is Stephen, okay? And it says, and Stephen, full of faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people. Signs and wonders were miracles for the Jewish people that believed, okay? Let's see. So, through the Holy Spirit worked many signs and wonders, and what they were there for in the book of Acts was to show Israel the blessings that are going to come in the kingdom for them. That's what these miracles and signs and wonders were all about. Okay, Israel, here's what's coming for you in the kingdom. All right, so, and it says, there arose certain of the synagogue, which is called the synagogue at the Libertines, and Cyrenians and Alexandrians and them of Cilicia and Asia, disputing with Stephen, okay? And they were not able to resist the wisdom and the spirit by which he spake. So there were people there that disputed with Stephen, and what are you talking about, okay? But there were there some stubborn men. Some listened, and some could not dispute or resist what Stephen was preaching. But the next verse in chapter 6, verse 11 says, Then they suborned men, which said, we have heard him speak blasphemous words against Moses and against God. And they stirred up the people and the elders, and the scribes came upon him and caught him and brought him to the council. Okay, so there were those, they stirred up trouble. So the scribes came and caught him and brought him to the council. They set up false witnesses, which said, this man ceases not to speak blasphemous words against the holy place and the law. For we have heard him say that this Jesus of Nazareth shall destroy this place and shall change the customs which Moses delivered us. Stephen never said that. Stephen taught God's word, and he told them Jesus was your Messiah. God's given them one more chance to believe that Jesus was their Messiah. And all that sat in the council looking steadfastly in him, saw his face as it had been the face of an angel. They saw Stephen, and they knew Stephen was a man from God, but they resisted Stephen's message. Now, in the Bible, if you remember, we had, remember I told you about the three strikes? In the Old Testament, Israel rejected God, the Father. Now they've rejected, in the New Testament, the Lord Jesus Christ, God the Son. Okay, so they've got two strikes against them. All right, but also, we're going to look at it a little different way. They rejected God the Father, but when they got into the New Testament times, after the 400 years of silence, God's messenger was John the Baptist. So they are still rejecting God the Father when they reject John the Baptist. So that's their strike one. Now their strike two is when they hung Jesus on the cross. And I'm talking about Israel, hung Jesus on the cross and crucified him. That was their strike two. So all through the Old Testament, all the way down to John the Baptist, strike one, they rejected God the Father, because John the Baptist was God the Father's messenger. Then they rejected Jesus Christ, strike two, okay? Now, I want you to look at Luke. We're going to turn back to Luke chapter 12, verse 10, okay? So here we are. Here's Stephen, and they're rejecting Stephen's message to them. And Stephen preached to them. He really got them. God brought you out of Egypt. You turned your back on it. All through the history, he's like, and all through history, God was on your side. The Lord God helped you through history. And everywhere down the road, you rejected him by serving other gods, heathen gods, okay? Stephen really preached hard at them, really laid it on the line. This is the facts, and this is what you did. Well, these men couldn't handle that. So that's when they bear the false witness against Stephen and said, you are teaching blasphemous against Moses and against our law. Stephen wasn't, he just laid out the truth. And sometimes, boys and girls, the truth hurts. And these guys were mad at Stephen for doing that, all right? So in Luke chapter 10, Luke chapter 12, verse 10, it says, and whosoever shall speak a word against the Son of Man, it shall be forgiven him. In other words, you can speak against God, you can speak against the Son of Man, the Lord Jesus Christ. But unto him that blasphemeth against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven. All right, now that's important, boys and girls, because the unpardonable sin for Israel was you could not speak against the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost. So you could speak against the Lord God, you could speak against the Lord Jesus Christ, his Son, but you could not speak against the Holy Ghost. All right, so what happened here is in chapter 7 is the story of Stephen starts out in verse 2. He says, men and brethren and fathers, hearken, the God of glory appeared unto our father Abraham. So he starts the whole process and he tells them about 40 years you were expired. You had 40 years in the wilderness. You know, he took you across the Red Sea. He fed you manna. He fed you quail. He gave you water. He took care of your needs, and you rejected him. Okay? So when Stephen gets done preaching in verse 54, chapter 7, he says, when ye heard these, okay, hold on. No, I want to go back to verse 51. Now remember, we just read Luke 12, verse 10. And in verse 51, Stephen preaches to the men of Israel there, ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, ye do always resist the Holy Ghost. As your fathers did, so do ye. In other words, boys and girls, he's saying to them in verse 51, you're committing that sin of Luke 12, verse 10. You rejected God the Father. You rejected God the Son. Now ye do resist the Holy Ghost, the person of the Holy Ghost. That was their unpardonable sin. This is their strike three, boys and girls. And the scriptures say, you can speak a word against the Son of Man, but unto him that blasphemeth against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven. There was no forgiveness for these men. They were blaspheming the Holy Ghost. Okay, so what happened then? It says in Acts chapter 7, verse 54, when they heard these things, they were cut to their heart and gnashed on Stephen with their teeth. Boys and girls, they jumped on him and bit him. But he, being full of the Holy Ghost, looked up steadfastly into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing on the right hand of God. And behold, I saw the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God. Boys and girls, Stephen looked up into heaven and he saw Jesus standing by the throne of the Father, standing on the right hand of God. Jesus was ready to come back and pour out his wrath on Israel. Now, remember our story? 6 weeks, God dealt with Israel. And the seventh week was to start. And the seventh week, Jesus was standing ready to come out and pour his wrath on unbelieving Israel and the world. He was ready to just fix everything. The wrath of God was coming, all right? And Stephen saw Jesus standing, ready to come back and pour out and make his enemies his footstool. That's what Stephen saw. We are still in time past right here. The prophetic program, the wrath that God warned Israel was coming, is about to happen. And next week, we're going to see what really happened, okay? So what happens here is, behold, okay, and they cried out with a loud voice and stopped their ears. These men couldn't stand it. They had gnashed on Stephen with their teeth. They couldn't hear anymore. They cast him out of the city and stoned him. And the witnesses laid down their clothes at a man's feet whose name was Saul. In other words, boys and girls, they gnashed on Stephen with their teeth. They drug him outside the city and they stoned him. That hurts. They stoned him till they killed him. But there was someone standing right there, boys and girls, and that was Saul. And they stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, Lord Jesus, Stephen cried out, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And he kneeled down and cried with a loud voice, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. They stoned Stephen, boys and girls, they killed him. But Saul, these men laid their coats at the feet of Saul. Boys and girls, they had committed strike three. They rejected God the Father into the New Testament times, and they rejected John the Baptist, God's messenger, strike one. Strike two, they rejected the Lord Jesus Christ and hung him on Calvary's cross. But strike three, according to Luke 12, verse 10, you cannot blaspheme the Holy Ghost. So, in our story, Israel had committed strike three. Israel is on the sidelines. So 6 weeks, and then Israel gets changed. They just get put aside. And God's going to turn to another program. And next week, we're going to talk about that program. And it was a secret, boys and girls. It was a mystery. No one knew about it. But God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. We're going to see next week why no one, did you ever try to keep a secret? We can't keep a secret, boys and girls. Someone will say, I'm going to tell you something, but don't tell anybody. Well, more than likely, someone said to them, I'm going to tell you this, don't tell anybody. And you turn around and tell somebody and say, don't tell anybody, it's a secret. You can't keep a secret. I can't keep a secret. But God Almighty kept a secret. All right. So we're going to make our transition from that bicycle with training wheels to the big bike where no training wheels. We're making that change, okay? We're making that change from tutoring the boys for 6 weeks. Now we're going to tutor the girls for a little while. And then later on, we're going to finish the boys 7 weeks, all right? Wonderful illustration of the transition in the book of Acts and the change that God is going to make to his program. All right, so now you have some worksheets and a think we pretty much covered all the answers. So there's two worksheets, all right? And then behind it, boys and girls, there's all kinds of extra worksheets to do. So I hope you enjoy your week. And it's exciting when we go through the books of the Bible. So we got to finish Acts, then we do Romans to Philemon, and then Hebrews to Revelation. So, and we'll be done with this series of lessons, okay? So this is lesson 41 now. So you should be using Lesson 41 worksheets. All right. Love you all. So glad to be back. And hopefully we can keep this going now and have our lessons each week. Have a wonderful week. Enjoy the nice weather. Oh, and by the way, this is Mother's Day. So happy Mother's Day to all your mothers. And don't forget your mothers on Mother's Day. Okay. All right. I love you. And I'll see you next week. Bye.